Since 1967, Israel's demolished about 46,000 Palestinian homes in the occupied territories.
Altermonde.
Now, this is on the background of many more homes that were demolished inside Israel. In fact, in 1948, during the Nakba and after, Israel demolished probably another 60,000 Palestinian homes. Entire villages, towns, urban areas were demolished, plus thousands more inside Israel between 1948 and today. So altogether, we estimate more than 120,000 Palestinian homes have been destroyed by Israel since 48, and 46,000 of them in the occupied territories since 1967. So we're talking about tens of thousands of homes, a tremendous displacement of the population. And that's exactly the point. And that is that the whole idea of Israel and of the Zionist ideology and movement behind it is to claim the entire country of Palestine, from the Mediterranean to the Jordan River, the entire country exclusively for the Jewish population. It is an exclusive claim. There is no place, no recognition that there is another people living in that country, a Palestinian people. And the process is called by Israel Judaization. We're Judaizing the country. We're making the country Jewish. So that for us in advocating a just peace, house demolitions becomes a very important and a very good issue, because what Israel tries to tell us all is that everything it does is for security, against terrorism, that we, Israelis, are in fact the victims. But if you look at the house demolition policy, you see that it's proactive. It has nothing whatsoever to do with security. Of the 46,000 houses, more than 99% had nothing whatsoever to do with security. Houses are demolished as well in military invasions. For example, last summer, 2014, in the invasion of Gaza, Israel destroyed about 18,000 Palestinian homes. Not targeted. They were simply collateral damage. They were simply in the way. So you don't need a policy for that. It's in the course of battle or warfare, and it happens. So the court has nothing to do about that, the Supreme Court or the Israeli courts or the law. It's simply military damage. The second is, again, Palestinians can't get building permits. They zone land in a way that forbids Palestinians to build homes. And then the legal pretext is, well, this is zoning. We've zoned this for public purposes, we've zoned this for roads, we've zoned this, and so the zoning seems to be a neutral planning mechanism for hiding a political agenda, of course. But the Supreme Court then, there's nothing illegal about it. The third form of demolition, and again, I say it's less than 1% of the homes demolished, is what's known as punitive demolitions. That's when the home of someone that's accused, not tried, sometimes they're dead, sometimes they're arrested, before they're even tried, their homes are destroyed if they're accused of a terrorist act, as a form of deterrence, you see. But it's collective punishment, which is illegal in international law. In other words, you're not punishing only that person. You're punishing the family. The person might even be dead. And not just the family, but sometimes the neighborhood, because it's an apartment. Israel's demolished the third floor of a five-story apartment building. So try to do that surgically. And the Supreme Court has allowed that under the guise of security. The Supreme Court has always said, really since the beginning of the state, we are not competent in areas of security. So if the army comes to the court and says, we have to do this, security trumps, it beats any of the law. Security is supreme. And the court simply says, okay. By moving house demolitions into the sphere of military security, then it's outside the jurisdiction, in a way, of the law. we're working to end the occupation totally and achieve a just peace. But the vehicle we've chosen to expose how the occupation works, why Israel's demolishing homes, what happens to the Palestinians, is house demolitions. Because it's a very visual and clear way you see exactly how Israel comes in and attacks Palestinians. That's become a very good way of showing how the occupation works, but also of resistance. We have activists, and first of all, we resist the demolition of homes. You never know when a house is going to be demolished. People get orders, but it can be 5 years later, it can be 10 years later. All of a sudden, the military comes and says to the family, you have 15 minutes to get your belongings out. So we never get a warning. We don't know. But Palestinians SMS us or call us. And if we can, we rush out and we try to get in front of bulldozers. We're inside the house, chained. We get on the roof to try to stop the demolition. And we've managed to save some houses that way. But we also reconstruct homes, rebuild homes, as political acts of resistance. It's not humanitarian. We do it together with Palestinians. They choose the houses to be rebuilt. And we rebuild homes that have been demolished as acts of resistance to occupation. We've built 189 homes over the last 15, 16 years. Now, if this was humanitarian, it wouldn't make any sense. 189 out of 46,000, that's nothing. And these are homes that could be redemolished because it's illegal to rebuild a demolished home. So a home, we've had homes demolished six times and rebuilt each time. That wouldn't make any sense if it was humanitarian. Why would you put money into a house that's going to be demolished again? But the political logic is different. The political logic is we resist, and if they demolish 100 times, we'll rebuild 101 times. We are not going to let the occupation win. We, as critical Israelis, will stay with the Palestinian families. We raise money abroad, and people come from all over the world to build with us. It takes us a couple weeks to build a home. And we're talking together and eating together and building together. And it's also very meaningful. When you come to a family that's, the family's demolished, not just the home. And they have nowhere to live and they're depressed and they're financially ruined and they're scared and intimidated. And it takes a lot of courage to rebuild because they can be arrested for rebuilding. They can be fined thousands of euros. So it takes a lot of courage for them to defy. And you come to a family, and you just see the ruins of the house. And 2 weeks later, the house is rebuilt. And you give the family the key. And our people help them move their furniture in. It's a very meaningful and moving experience.